Thank you, as always, for being so disciplined and gulping down your drinks and sitting back on the chairs. I was just telling Jairam that it's an indication of both the unpopularity of the issue of environment and the unpopularity of the Congress that this is the lowest turnout we've ever had for Algebra. And it's again a wake-up call to the Congress that they've got to get their act together. The quality of the audience is fine, but the quantity is disappointing. And next time, please, we're going to have some of the old stalwarts of the BJP, so put in a better show for them, you know, given the fashion of the season. But I'm personally looking forward to this session with Sagarika Ghose, because as I said earlier, to really assess Indira Gandhi is to assess who we are as a nation today. It's the blueprint of everything in many ways that we are today was really set in Indira Gandhi's time. And reading Sagarika's book, as Jairam said, you know, his book has a lot of primary material and Sagarika's book doesn't. But like a good journalist, she has distilled the learnings and understanding from many other biographies and people who've known Indira Gandhi well to really arrive at a distillate of that character. And when you read that, what really comes home is that the story of Indira Gandhi in many ways is a cautionary tale. It's a morality story about both the comfort and the danger of a muscular leader. Indira Gandhi was really, in many ways, the character that everybody wanted at that time. People were sick of the confusion and the ineptitude and corruptions, the noise, the strikes, and people wanted that muscular leader. People loved her. They called her the Durga. She was the supreme leader, and everything she did was really what nationalism was. She equated herself with the country. And in many ways, we're really playing out that entire scenario again today. And to listen to Sagarika and to understand that journey that she's made in assessing Indira Gandhi is, as I said, in many ways, a cautionary tale for ourselves today to understand where India is and why we are the way we are. So to get into that fascinating story, a riveting story, really, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sagarika Ghose. I could tell you about her resume, but I think the one word that sums her up is not that she was with the CNN or with the Outlook or that she's with Times of India now, but really that she is the hated word libtard, which is the liberal retard. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome someone I'm proud to be a part of, the community of liberal retards, Sagarika Ghose. So thank you for being here, Sagarika. I actually would have loved to have some congressmen along with you to help grill this whole history of Indira Gandhi, but Jairam ducked and ran. He preferred to speak about the environment. So let me just plunge right into it. As I said, your book is a distillate of pretty much every biography that's been written of Indira Gandhi. You also did a lot of conversations with people who knew her intimately and are still alive. Most of the public events of her life are well known, so we won't go into that. In your own study of Indira, what was the surprises that you came across? You know, what was the surprise insights that you came across?
Well, Shoma, I think one of the first things that I discovered about myself and assessing Indira Gandhi was how disastrous her policies were, but what a graceful and charming person she was. So, you know, she reminds me of that poem, I don't know if anyone's familiar, The Lady of Shalott. Where there's this woman who's cursed for some mysterious reason, who's caged in this castle of her anxieties and insecurities and angers and paranoias about people, but is a person of tremendous charm and grace when you get to know her as a person. And this duality kind of fascinated me, you know, and I was, as I was researching her, I thought, my God, she's making a mess of the country, but she's a great person, you know. So the duality that I discovered of her was a very interesting one for me. It was very interesting for me to delve into Indira Gandhi, and a challenge, I think, that I didn't allow her persona to overshadow her policies. Because, my book is emphatically not a hagiography. In fact, it is, I hope, an empathetic critique. So as I read through all the biographies of others, at last count 150 biographies, I read 80. You know, she's been called the sluice gate through which has flown a voluminous amount of literature. So as I, you know, read through all these books, I found that again, this constant duality, there was so much personal detail about her and so much warmth in the way people recollected her. But of course, the undeniable fact of her very ruinous policies, the kind of advisors she had, the road she took. But then the big surprise for me also was the level of personal unhappiness she endured, you know? And in spite of that, this amazing fighting spirit. You know, when Jairam was talking to you, I felt like telling him that if the Congress needs a leader today, it does need an Indira Gandhi. You know, it needs that fighting spirit. I mean, think about it. You're routed in 1971. Within 2 years, you're back with a two-thirds majority in a spectacular comeback that no other politician has perhaps achieved ever in the history of India. So that's the kind of fighting spirit she had. She was tireless. At 60, she climbed onto an elephant, barebacked, without a howdah, and crossed a flooded river. So she had tremendous fighting spirit, raw elemental courage. But in spite of all this, I think the big surprise to me was the level of personal humiliation and grief that she endured perhaps all her life. You know, one of the big discoveries to me was her relationship with Nehru. I don't think she was even very close to Nehru. I think he was disappointed in her. He was quite disappointed at her academic inadequacies. And I think she felt judged by him. She probably felt that she couldn't live up to the ideal he wanted her to be. And you know, the freedom fighters, the founding fathers of India were bad dads. You know, they were not very good fathers. I mean, they were good at founding a nation, but not good at looking after their families or their wives. And he was quite judgmental about Indira and expecting her to, you know, jump, show jump and stand on her head and swim and ride and read the best books and go to Oxford and get a first and, you know, and be much more spectacular than actually she was. So I think all her life she sought his benediction, but in the end also scorned his legacy in a way by overturning everything that he stood for. So her relationship with Nehru to me was a big revelation.
Yeah, in fact, that's a fascinating strand that you've picked up, because again, when you look at it superficially, he wasn't one of the bad dads because he showered so much of apparent emotional and intellectual capital on her, you know, through the letters, through the reading of her. But, you know, you've come across wonderful details like him writing to Vijayalakshmi Pandit and saying that Indu has already developed the worst characteristics of the personalities I don't like, you know, expecting everybody to wait on her hand and foot and things like that. So yes, you're right that she, at least through your book, it refracts that she was almost always moving away from what Nehru wanted her to be, and she was seeking comfort in other kinds of male relationships. And could you speak, you know, and I did want the focus of our conversation to be on that morality tale, the cautionary tale aspect of muscular leadership. But I'll come to that a little later. Just some of the more personal details, that who were the male stereotypes that she was actually drawn to finally? You know, who were the big men in her life?
You know, what you said about morality plays exactly spot on. That's exactly her story. And if we look at it, you know, through history, whether it's Hitler or Mao or Aurangzeb or Louis XIV or Indira Gandhi or Narendra Modi, you know, leaders ruling with an iron hand through history have generally created havoc. You know, it's the people who don't wield power so spectacularly and don't wield power so openly who are actually perhaps more effective leaders, like Vajpayee or perhaps even a Manmohan Singh in his first term, but we'll come to that later. But the personal aspects, again, I found fascinating because, you know, Shoma, think about it. I mean, you are an only child in the early 20th century India. It's very rare to be an only child. Most people would have had at least a sibling. So you're an only child of the eldest son of this enormously successful, fascinating family. You're the eldest child of the eldest son of this illustrious dynasty. So the expectation was that you would be male, but you weren't male, but you were kind of brought up as male, and your circumstances kind of made you more boy than girl. You know, she was deferred to by this domestic staff. She was treated as a boy, even by her mother. She was dressed as a boy. She signed her letters Indu boy. Her father called her soldier boy. So she was never the girl Indira. She was the girl boy Indu boy, you know. So I think she drew a lot from, and I think the man inside the woman was a very dominant trait about her. The man inside the woman of Indira Gandhi was a very dominant feature of her personality. You know, and I think her grandfather, you know, that was another surprise to me in the book. You know, Motilal, again, I mean, discovering the personality of Motilal, who I had never come across before. I mean, this incredible amalgam of Persian and Sanskrit and English, and he used to speak all these three languages. He was the richest lawyer in India. There was this 43-room house. He could horse ride. He used to speak fluent English. His wife was a completely traditional woman who used to speak only in Hindi. They had these two separate kitchens. They had these two separate lives in their home. They had different kinds of toilets. East and West existed as these two universes in Anand Bhavan. And Motilal presided over this huge mansion, and every evening at 6:30 would be heard saying koi hai, and you know, the dimple scotch would be brought out, and he would have his scotch and his wife would be having vegetarian food in the kitchen. I mean, he's a really fascinating character and a very magnetic, large, big person. And I think all her life Indira drew from that example of her grandfather, and I think she warmed to that kind of, you know, alpha male, big, extroverted, big, loud men, rather than the philosophical idealist like her father. You know, yeah, I think she was kind of put off by the father's soft-spoken, sort of lofty intellectualism.
And in fact, you know, you say that she chose Feroz Gandhi also for those reasons,
yeah,
almost
in a way,
as a rebellion against Nehru.
Yeah.
And of course, the big man in her life was Sanjay Gandhi, who was
like
absolutely
that in a way.
Brute force, you know, so.
Who was her in a way, you know? I think he was her come to masculine life. You know, I think she had always thought of herself as Indu boy, right? So I think when Sanjay Gandhi, and there's a line that Pupul Jaikar has in a book, which I haven't quoted, where she actually looks at him and sees him as this lithe, strong, masculine force, and almost with a certain envy that this is what she wanted to be when she was young. You know, she wanted to aspire to that young, masculine ideal. So I think Sanjay Gandhi was her come to life. He was Indu boy, come to new life.
That's,
you know,
a frightening thought.
Yeah, it, in a way, it was like her alter ego, you know. Yeah. Sorry, this is too much psychoanalysis. But
well, you know, I don't know if many of you noticed that quote there, but Sagarika has it in the book that when she went to meet Lyndon Johnson and he asked the Indian ambassador to the US that she doesn't like being called Madam Indira Gandhi, so what should I call her? And Indira Gandhi replied to the ambassador that, well, my cabinet colleagues call me Sir, so tell Mr. Johnson that he can do that too, you know. So that kind of sums up the personality of Indira Gandhi. But again, before we move on to the political stuff, Sagarika, if you could share that story again, what I found was a surprise vulnerability, you know, that sheer tragic story of Indira Gandhi, where you assume that she's this alpha personality, but that when she came out of power, she had no house to go to and pretty much no money. And that isolation, if you can just share some of those stories, and that she gave away Anand Bhavan and 43-roomed house in the peak of her power. She just gave it away to the country as a museum. But if you could share that time when she was out of power.
Yeah, I think the time when she was out of power is very is a big contrast to what she was, what we see politicians now. You know, I mean, she had lived in that house in the prime ministerial bungalow for 11 years, and she was tossed out. She had absolutely nothing. She had Menaka Gandhi's jeep. She had five trunks full of her books. She had her five dogs, and she had her children, and she had no money. She lived actually on the money made possible to her by her father's royalties. Her father's books were bringing her royalties, and that was the kind of money she lived on. She had no other income. There was some land in Mehrauli, but that house was not built. So she was actually completely tossed out of the power elite and the circle she had lived in literally all her life. Because remember, she was first Nehru's companion for 17 years and then prime minister for 11 years. So, you know, she'd been there for 28 years and she was tossed out. Nobody came to see her. Nobody paid a visit to her. And in fact, there's a very poignant story where when she went to a particular function at the British High Commissioner and everybody gathered and nobody was looking at her. And the Prime Minister came in, Morarji Desai came in, and everybody rushed to him. And Bipul Jaikar said, no, come on, let's go because you're not wanted here. And she said, no, I want to stay on. I want to stay on. And she wanted to stay on at that function, even though she was marginalized. Nobody was talking to her. Nobody was looking at her. But she stayed on. And she made it a point to go to every function she was invited to. Wherever she was invited, she would go and she would make her presence felt and she would be marginalized and she wouldn't be spoken to, but she would go. So I thought it was rather pathetic that this mighty dictator would then honor each and every invitation and go to every function she was invited to in Delhi and not leave if she was slighted.
Yeah. And unusually, you know, Sagarika mentioned that she had nowhere to go. She actually stayed in a friend's house because they had no house to go to. And those are the aspects of Indira Gandhi and, again, political life that we'll never see again, you know, where a political leader has actually nowhere to go because they've amassed so much wealth in the meantime, you know. But to come to the morality tale aspect of it, Sagarika, for me at least, one of the most interesting things about reading your book was that it kept feeling as if contemporary history was playing itself out again like that, you know? And that's something I'd like to explore, that it seems as if the exact circumstances are playing itself out again. The, you know, the JP movement has its mirror in Arvind Kejriwal's movement, the impatience of society with effete leadership, all of that, you know? And the way she emasculated democracy is pretty much the way we are experiencing it now, and but still loving the leader. And Mr. Modi, everybody admires him, respects him, but he is in many ways destroying the fabric of democracy. But rather than focus on him, can we first look at all the ways that she destroyed democracy? What would you pick?
Absolutely, Shoma. As you
emergency
say,
is too obvious, so the other ones.
Yeah. No, you've put your finger on it. I think as people, we're seduced by power. You know, we're very captivated by power. Our society is structurally conditioned, I think, by violence. Our most popular film at the moment is Bahubali, and Dabang is our hero. So I think we're very captivated by power, and the more irrational the act, like demonetization could be an irrational act, but because it's a flourish of power, we're seduced by that. You know, we're captivated by this Dabangism. So I think the more irrational an act, the more powerful it is, the more of a power display it is, we're kind of captivated by that. So I think she was part of that kind of leader, you know, who captivated by her power and her ability to use power, her ability to understand power. I think the way she fundamentally destroyed, I don't think constitutional democracy was her thing at all. You know, I mean, I think it was sort of order and let's get on with it and, you know, let me, you know, put down the packs Indira everywhere around India. I don't think she was willing to let the processes of constitutional democracy take their course. You know, I think her biggest mistake was to split the Congress in 1969. Because when she split the Congress, she made a party entirely dependent on her. It was a party all around her. It was about her. She took over complete control of the organs of the party. She dominated that particular Congress. So this was not Nehru's Congress. This was not Gandhi's Congress. This was not the multilateral federal Congress where leaders could survive. This was a Congress where any show of political virility meant that you're off with your head. You know, any show of threat to Indira Gandhi, off with your head. So I think her original sin was what she did to the Congress. You know, we can blame Rahul Gandhi today, but frankly, the decline of the Congress, I believe, started in 1969.
Yeah, and it's,
you know, and it's been going on since for decades. What can poor Rahul Gandhi do? I mean, had Indira Gandhi not died in 1984, I don't think the Congress would have won 400 seats. No way. I mean, her death was the gift she gave to the Congress party. Her assassination was a parting gift to her son. But if she hadn't died, I think the Congress would have limped to, say, you know, single largest or something like that. So, you know, as I say in my book, her death made her a martyr and her death rescued the Congress for a while. But had she faded into irrelevance, I think the Congress would have declined by the early 80s.
Yeah.
Because she was systematically destroying the party. And she didn't realize it. You know, she didn't realize that by foisting her own personality, and people didn't realize it. Because I think what happens is, you know, in an illiberal society, when the energy of the supreme leader is very high, it actually masks the larger institutional catastrophe that is happening underneath. You know, right now we see Mr. Modi dashing from here to here. He's energetic. He's all alpha male. And we think, wow, good stuff is happening. But actually, there is institutional corrosion that's going on. It's being masked. And that's exactly what she did, you know?
Yeah, in fact, again, everyone focuses on the emergency. But I don't know how many of all of us know this stuff. But just to reiterate it, I think she dismissed 39 governments, state governments. 36 governments in 15, 16 years. And she decimated every party leader at the state level that had any personality.
She destroyed every leader in the Congress. You know, whether it's Devrajars, whether it's so many of them, you know, the entire syndicate, the Kamrajas, the Nijalingappas, the Sanjeev Reddys, everybody was just driven out. If you're not loyal to me, if you don't accept my suzerainty, you can't stay in the Congress. And this is the opposite of Nehru. Nehru swore by his rivals. You know, the opposite of Gandhi. I mean, think about it. Gandhi invites his biggest detractors, Ambedkar, to head the Constituent Assembly. He invites his greatest enemy, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, offers him to become Prime Minister of India. So Gandhi actually reaches out the most to his enemies. You know, which is really the lesson we need to learn from Gandhi, that he reached out the most to his enemies. But she, I think, was not able to imbibe this lesson at all. She did not imbibe constitutional democracy, either from Nehru or from Gandhi. I think in a way she was seeking revenge for her father. You know, she felt that her father was betrayed in 1962, that his colleagues had turned on him, that he was forced to quit. So I think she took revenge on the colleagues by just booting them all out.
You know, as I said earlier, that there is that comfort and danger of the muscular leader. And to just bring that back again to present moment, that one is, I mean, by and large, and certainly electoral arithmetic shows that people are drawing comfort from the leadership of Mr. Modi. But it really struck one that this same sort of decimation of the party, where the BJP no longer counts, state leaders don't count. You can hardly remember the names of chief ministers in most of the states anymore. And the opposition is decimated. Do you think we are in some ways in a, you know, again, in that delusion of comfort today than then? Because at least with Indira Gandhi, there was a very strong opposition at that time, which we don't have today. Would you say that there
absolutely,
is that?
Absolutely, Shoma. As you, I know, I noticed as you had up on the introduction to my book, you said she wrote the playbook, and that's what I write in my book. I mean, the rules of modern, of Indian politics today, the playbook was written by Indira Gandhi. The supremo cult, overriding institutions, dominating the party, dominating the government, reaching out over the head of the party to directly to the people, a kind of abrasive populism. You know, Gandhi's satyagraha was exhorting everyone to be their best self. You know, you joined politics because you wanted to be your best self. You wanted to rise to the highest standards of morality and satyagraha and truth and nonviolence. Hers was appealing to your worst self. You know, you appeal to your worst kind of populist self. So I think she kind of wrote the playbook of politics today. I mean, think about it. Mamata Banerjee, Nitish Kumar, Lalu, Jayalalitha, Sonia Gandhi, Amit Shah, Narendra Modi, everybody is playing by the Indira Gandhi playbook. She wrote the Indirafication of Indian politics, I think, is a huge reality today. It is the reality, which is why I thought this book was quite relevant, because when I was reading her life, I thought, my God, this is exactly what they do today. You know, when a politician tries to be a supremo, when a politician overrides his party, when a politician does not listen to the institutions, to the judiciary, to the executive, to the legislature, when he's just all in all, when a supreme executive looms over every organ of state, then you have to say, well, thank you, Mrs. Gandhi. You know, you did it all. And that was really what she did.
You know, you really see that playing out, as you said, because it's a distillate of her life and all the, you know, understanding that others got. You really see that playing out, you know, the absolute decimation of democracy that's going on and the comfort that one can draw. I keep using the word comfort because it can be very lulling while the process is on, but you only see the shattering of it later. You know, to speak about this going back to the people, it's fascinating how very often, and again, she draws her real power from the people. They keep giving her that mandate. And, you know, as you've mentioned, Mr. Modi or Mamata Banerjee or all these presidential form of leaders, they do draw their mandate from the people. But why do you think she called off the emergency? You know, you again have some very interesting insights. Even during the emergency, there were many who loved the emergency. We have a soft emergency going on now. It's very efficient, it's comfortable. There's no strikes, no populist movements going on. The country seems to be in control. Why did she call it off? And can you share some insights about her psychological frame of mind during the emergency, which people might not know about?
Right, I think that's a very good question. That, you know, she is the only dictator in the world, I think, who imposed an emergency and then voluntarily gave it up. You know, she actually submitted to the power of the vote. So in a way, she paradoxically strengthened the vote because she took away democratic rights, but then submitted to the power of the vote again. So I think in a way she strengthened paradoxically Indian democracy. You know, I think what we can also draw comfort from was that here was a leader who controlled the news, controlled the press, controlled the government, controlled everything, but still the Indian people defeated her in 1977. So, you know, that's a cautionary tale for every leader, that you can control everything, but the people out there, you can control the media, you can control the news, but if the people want to defeat you, they will defeat you. So I think that's something to learn. I think the reason why she called off the emergency was, I think at the end of the day, she probably felt that she would win. You know, there were a lot of people who told a lot, the intelligence bureau was telling her that the emergency has been economically very beneficial. There were two good harvests and that you might go to the people and they might welcome you. Remember, she was marked by this one very important quality, which she believed she was indispensable. She believed her own indispensability was never in doubt. The fact that her family and her bloodline was destined to rule India was a conviction with Indira Gandhi all her life. No doubt on this bothered her mind at all. My family, my sons, I will rule India. This conviction stayed with her all her life. So when she finally decided to call elections, I think somewhere she may have thought that I might even win. But then, you know, my more empathetic reason, and, you know, having delved into her life so much, is I think she began to remember her father. I think at the end of the day, she was Nehru's daughter. And I think at some point, you know, when the tales of sterilization reached her, and the P.N. Dhar writes very evocatively about this. You know, when the Nasbandi campaign was all over and she was getting these stories about men were being dragged out of cinema halls and being sterilized, they were dragged out of bus queues and sterilized, and people would send her representations about how particularly the underprivileged, the minorities, the poor, they were being forcibly sterilized. I think at some point she must have grown nostalgic for a different kind of politics. She must have. You know, I think the presence of Nehru must have appeared and lingered, and she must have heard his voice. And she must have felt that, you know, at somewhere I'm doing wrong. Because, you know, there are also the very interesting accounts that she used to suffer from depression. And she'd gone to Jay Krishnamurti and broken down and cried. And, you know, and Jay Krishnamurti had consoled her and said, you know, you better call this whole thing off. So she was troubled by it. I think by the end, she was very troubled by it.
You have a that's an aspect of
the twitching of her. She developed this nervous twitch in her eye as well.
Yeah, she developed that twitch, and when people were telling her about this sterilization, you, at least in your book, you say that she broke down crying and said, "Main kya karun, main kya karun." You know, so that's an aspect of Indira Gandhi you wouldn't expect. You know, again, moving on further, that in terms of surprises, delving so deeply into her book and sharing the personal memories, what were other aspects of her character, you know, little insights vis-a-vis her vulnerability to people or things that really made up the Indira Gandhi? What were the other surprises for you, you know, in terms of love, romance, her relationship with Feroz Gandhi, whatever you might pick?
Well, I think you know, personally, she had a very, very interesting life. Her relationship with her mother, I thought, was deeply, deeply moving. You know, Kamala came into this very sophisticated, very westernized household. And the key to advancement in that household was wit and beauty and accomplishment. And Kamala had beauty, but she didn't neither had wit nor accomplishment. And she was treated very badly by her sisters-in-law and by her mother-in-law. And so from a very young age, Indira Gandhi was very, very protective of her mother. And I think from, you know, she had her little arms around her mother even from the age of four. So that constant standing guard over Kamala and protecting this very ailing, frail woman, I think that was something that, again, I didn't know the extent of it. I didn't know how fiercely she loved her mother and the passion with which she protected her mother in the face of her enemies. I think the other thing that struck me about her was, you know, again, constantly trying to live up to this ideal of the Nehrus. She was an alpha female, you know, she wasn't a Gungi Guria. She was deep down, she was very ambitious, very ruthless. And under those shadowed eyes, there was a ruthless fighting spirit. But she looked very, you know, she looked when she was growing up very very skinny. She was not beautiful. She was ordinary looking. And I think she always had a problem with that because the Nehrus were again very accomplished. And Nehru was very handsome and Vijayalakshmi was very beautiful. And Motilal was staggeringly handsome. And so I think she had an issue with her own feelings of inadequacy, which is why at one point she ate half a dozen bananas. You know, she went to breakfast once and she said, I had to prove that somehow I was a Nehru and I was capable of a lot of feats, of accomplishments. So she polished off half a dozen bananas as a kind of show of her, of what she could achieve. But I think, again, she had these feelings of inadequacy. I think her lack of academic achievement was something that she obviously felt that her father did not like and was deeply disappointed about. You know, her failure to gain a degree at Oxford, I think, was very, very significant because she marries Feroz right after her dropping out of Oxford. It's almost as if she's telling her father, look, I don't care. I know you're disappointed in me. I know I didn't get that Oxford degree. I know I'm not an Oxford graduate. I don't care about you. I'm marrying Feroz who you don't like. You know, so I think her lack of academic achievements was something that her father really was very, he was very disappointed in Indira all his life. You know, he was very sort of dismissive. Nehru's letters about her are really quite unkind. And I don't think he thought much of her at all. I think he would be very surprised if he knew she had become prime minister. Yeah.
I think it's fascinating that...
So his dismissiveness of her is, again, what I found quite surprising. You know?
Yeah, because that's the other insight, that in fact he did not groom her for leadership and he never shared decision-making with her. He thought she was the hostess of the house. And he groomed her mind, but he wasn't preparing a dynasty at all. And
he tried to groom her. I think he tried to groom her to be intellectual like him. You know, I mean, Glimpses of World History is truly it's a masterwork. And Nehru was an intellectual. I think Nehru would have been a college professor or a philosopher if he hadn't been a politician. But she clearly wasn't an intellectual.
But it's fascinating, you said that, you know, people thought of her as a Gungi Guria, but right inside her, she wasn't. And there's an interesting story where a BBC journalist asks, you know, when your father dies, would you think of taking up prime ministership? And she said, 90% I won't, you know, but she kept that leeway of 10% for herself. Yeah. So, you know, just moving back to the present day, Sagarika, that what are the other stories of caution that we can pick from Indira's life which pertain to our current circumstances, you know? And also this obsession with the family, this belief that the Congress has that only the Gandhis can rule it. We saw Jairam's evasion of that question, and I think it's the most frustrating, not because we are Congress acolytes, but this country needs an opposition, and Mr. Gandhi, Rahul Gandhi, is not providing it. But the Congress can't seem to look beyond the Gandhis. And can you explain how that DNA took
over?
That's
absolutely right. As you say, you know, I think she instituted Dynasty Raj. Indira Gandhi created Dynasty Raj. I don't think Nehru groomed her. I don't think Nehru thought she could ever be anything more than a minor politician. I don't think Nehru ever thought of her as anything more than a helper, as someone who would, you know, be a minor woman's chairperson on some board, or, you know, some kind of political help. I don't think Nehru had any ambitions for her, which is why I think she tried to make up in a way for the fact that her father didn't propel her to greatness by propelling her own children to greatness, you know. But I don't think Nehru had any ambitions for her. You know, the most crucial date in Indian history post-Nehru, I feel, is 11th January 1966. Can anyone tell me what happened on 11th January 1966? Shastri died. You know, if Lal Bahadur Shastri hadn't died, I wonder what India's post-Nehru history would have been like. Because the fact is, he died. There was nobody else, the syndicate, that then the Congress gang of party bosses could turn to. And they turned to this Gungi Guria because they thought she would be like the king and queen of England. They would get her on board. She would be a lump of clay. They would mold and remold her. And she would do their bidding. She became their nemesis. So I think that she instituted family Raj in a way that Nehru would never have dreamed of, you know. And she created the dynasty. If there's anyone who created the dynasty, it's Indira Gandhi. So there's a lot we have to blame Indira Gandhi for.
In fact, can you share that story about P.N. Haksar, you know, because yeah, it, in a way it encapsulates this whole thing.
Yeah. You know, I mean, the Bangladesh war was her triumphant moment, right? It was the time when I think she showed the most enormous courage that I think any political leader has shown so far. I mean, think about it. There's a U.S. Warship which is coming towards you in the Bay of Bengal. The whole world is against you. You know, the U.S. is calling you an aggressor. In spite of all this, you take all this on board and you invade East Pakistan. You fight the war. In 14 days, the war is over. You declare ceasefire. You've liberated Bangladesh. That was all, in a way, from my research, a lot of it was Haksar. You know, her first term was so successful because of P.N. Haksar. I believe Jairam is writing a biography of P.N. Haksar. P.N. Haksar, I would strongly urge you guys, I mean, if you've not read about P.N. Haksar, read about this man. What a remarkable guy he was. I mean, this handsome Kashmiri Pandit, erudite, fluent in Persian, in Sanskrit, and a terrific practitioner of realpolitik. The only thing is, of course, he was a leftist ideologue and pulled her firmly down the leftist path. But I think Haksar was her ticket to glory in her first term. So P.N. Haksar was the reason why she did as well as she did in her first term. But without P.N. Haksar, and that's exactly what happened to her. And you know, P.N. Haksar was shunted out. The man responsible for her glory years from 67 to 71 was P.N. Haksar. And P.N. Haksar was the only one who had the guts to tell her that, listen, you are the Prime Minister of India. You're not Sanjay Gandhi's mother. Don't keep indulging your son. You know, and don't give him so many contracts, because he'd come back from Britain. He was, the whole government was bending over backwards to give him Maruti. You know, the first Make in India story was Maruti, I guess. So, you know, I mean, so the entire state was bending over backwards. And Haksar told her that don't become, this is the quote he said, that don't become Sanjay's mother. Remember, you are the Prime Minister of India. And in a few months, Haksar had lost his job. She turfed him out. So the man who was responsible for her glory years was turfed out. And not only was he turfed out, in 1975, in the emergency, his family owned a textile store, which was run by his 85-year-old granduncle. That store was raided. His granduncle was arrested. All on Sanjay Gandhi's orders. And this was P.N. Haksar, who had made Indira Gandhi in her first term. So that's how ruthless she was, and that's how dedicated she was to her son. You know, I think ruthless was really her middle name. Her Congress would not have been, say, humane enough to reach out to the diverse groups that perhaps today's Congress has. You know, I think she would have probably put Kanhaiya Kumar in jail. I think so. I think she would have. Well, I mean, she was not willing to cede the nationalist space.
Yeah.
Indira Gandhi was not going to cede the nationalist space. She was, I'm the nation.
Yeah.
You know, she was Elizabeth I. I don't want to drill holes into your soul, but you have to be loyal to me. Yeah. If you're not loyal to me, you're in jail. That's about it. So she was no cuddly teddy bear.
Let's open this up. And I think that's you know, when you read this book and you really look at Indira Gandhi's life, that's the thing that really comes to, and which for me was again, like I said, a reminder of the kind of phase we're living through, where one leader seems to be the nation. And, you know, love for the leader is equated with love for nationalism. Yeah, let me start with you and then go there.
The family, and the Gandhi family or the Nehru family, is it the family which is there, or is it the creation of the Congress Party by itself? Because other than Sanjay Gandhi, from what I'm hearing from you, it's where Indira Gandhi actually indulged. It seems to be the Congress Party's created the family as to be the neutral canvas and the neutral leadership, because they can't sort their problems out themselves. What do you think about this?
Well, the Congress Party today has been created by the family. You know, when she split the Congress in 1969, the great split took place. That was the Indira Congress that became the Congress. And then in 78, it split again. So, if the, you know, the Swaran Singhs and the YB Chavans, they went out. And again, only that loyal group stayed with her. That is that first loyal and the second loyal. So, there's a core group of loyalists around Indira Gandhi, the cluster around the family. That is the Congress of today. So the Congress of today is certainly not the Congress Party which we know as Nehru's party or Gandhi's party. This is this after one split and the second split. So there have been two splits. In two splits, the loyalist split, loyalist faction is the Congress Party of today. So without the family, this cluster around the family can't function. They can't survive. You know, they will have to actually, I think, disintegrate. They will have to, I think the Congress Party needs to implode, you know, and make way for a new force. Because the more it continues to occupy, artificially occupy the sort of libtard space, it's never going to have, India is never going to have an opposition. So this Congress has to go. It has to implode, or it has to reinvent itself. I don't think it can reinvent itself, you know. So it has to wither away. And we have to see a new force, which is what Gandhi wanted in the beginning. Gandhi didn't want Congress to become a political party. He was like, it's the independence movement party. It has to disband. It has to stop existing. And it has to now function as another group that operates within democracy. So this particular Congress, I think, is a highly artificial creation and is centered around the family and is structurally based around the family. So it has to actually disintegrate. In fact, in my opinion,
I second that.
if I can be the...
Although we can't afford a time when we don't have an opposition party, so at least they are numerically, whatever he said, outnumbered, but they're an opposition. Yeah.
While you may be correct in saying that Indira Gandhi inspired the current breed of contemporary leaders who are, say, dictatorial in their approach and in their like governance or the lack of it, but the a subtle yet fundamental difference remains that Indira Gandhi was bold enough to call an emergency, whereas right now the environment that we are living in, it's sort of an undeclared emergency. So would you call that as a point of difference?
That's a very good question. That's a very good question. I think she openly declared the emergency through law, and she legally declared that this was going to be an emergency, and then she rolled back the emergency. I think what we're seeing now is an emergency. We're certainly living in times of emergency, but it's apparently not an emergency. I think, you know, I think it's cyclical. I think every few years we have to realize what is democracy. You know, I think every few years the Indian public is called upon to fight for democracy. They fought for democracy in 1977 against Mrs. Gandhi, and we now again have to fight for democracy. Democracy is not easy. It's not going to come to us easily. It's not going to come to us handed on a plate and somebody says, this is democracy, go and do what you want. We have to fight for it. We have to really strain every nerve and sinew to get it. And I think, you know, it's going to have to happen cyclically. Clearly, God is sending challenges to us every few years, you know, that we have to fight repeatedly for democratic freedoms.
Yeah, but I suppose it's harder to fight now because you don't see it so clearly as, you know.
But I think, you know, again, we're called, so many of us are now thinking, what is freedom, right? how do I conceptualize my individual rights? Do I have the right to eat meat? Do I have to be vegetarian? Can I dress the way I want? Can I love the person I want to? Can I live the way I want to? Can I see the movies I want? Can I read the books I want? Can I have the religion I want? You know, so we're being asked to renew and re-examine our freedoms. We're being asked to question how far the state can go in assaulting our freedoms, and how far are we going to be loyal to a state which is assaulting our basic freedoms, the freedom to eat, hello, the freedom to wear what you want, the freedom to love whom you want. You know, I mean, the state is now laying down laws on romance, on, you know, Romeo squads, on movies being banned, and you know, and books and all of that. So I think every few years we're forced to renegotiate our relationship with power, and to understand what freedom means. What does freedom really mean to all of us? We've taken it for granted for too long. I think now we have to fight for it again. Last question.
If I can be the devil's advocate, I think what Indira Gandhi did was not really just her. I mean, I'm not a fan of her, so let me come with the disclaimer. But sycophancy and subservience has been in our genes for generations. For 700 or 800 years, I stand to be corrected, the Muslims ruled us, and then came the Britishers. So I think we've had this weakness in this country to be led. Otherwise, if you look at it, there was a, you know, at a certain point of time, we had Atal Bihari Vajpayee, who actually would forget Jaswant Singh's name. I mean, one time he was at the Red Fort and he forgot his chapel and he has to be reminded. And then the other was Rahul Gandhi. And then, you know, how Pulak Chatterjee ran out of 10 Janpath and Manmohan Singh was reduced. And Rahul Gandhi tearing the ordinance. So I think this gene has been in us for a very long time, because if I don't want to be led, how can somebody lead me? I mean, look at the political situation now, one. And two, being a Sikh, I just saw, you know, we're on Indira Gandhi, so end of the day was Sikhs. So, I mean, I do not take pride. It's been a load on my chest that what the guards did was unwanted for. They should have been the course of law we should have taken. So I don't appreciate what the guards have done, irrespective to what that happened. And it's been an opportunity for me to get that off my chest. And number three, and the last, is that Indira Gandhi can be known for two things. One is dictatorship, and the other was she institutionalized corruption. Thank you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think sycophancy is the scourge of feudal societies, and sycophancy was something that Nehru tried so hard to actually root out. You know, I'm sorry, but Nehru is a bit of a hero for me. He just tried so hard. You know, he tried so hard to change. He tried so hard to prove his own father wrong. Remember, Motilal didn't want India to become independent. Motilal wanted India to remain within the fold of dominion status of the British Empire. And he used to mock Jawaharlal for his raging, tearing propaganda for a free India. So it's almost as if Nehru had to prove a point to his own father that no, India could be a constitutional democracy. No, India could be modern. No, India could be a people who could conquer religious fanaticism. And you know, while researching Indira, I realized why Nehru and Gandhi kept harking to higher ideals. Because, you know, traditionally we are religious fanatics. You know, religious fanaticism is so strong in this country among so many people that's why you have to hark to higher ideals in order to make democracy work. And you're absolutely right, she institutionalized sycophancy, she institutionalized corruption, she created a venal and corrupt political system, which perhaps she personally wasn't corrupt, because as we've said, she didn't have her home to go to when she was thrown out, but she created a horribly corrupt and venal regime. So I think poor Rahul Gandhi has to deal with a lot of Dadi's problems.
Okay, we'll have to stop it there. There's just one last story to end on a positive note, and something that we can draw from Indira. Again, reading the book, that just before her assassination, even after the disaster of Operation Blue Star, it's important to remember that when they had removed all the Sikh bodyguards from her contingent, she asked for the Sikh bodyguards to be put back on her detail. And she said, I will not have them removed from my universe. And she was shot for that. But I think That again is the story that we should cling to, that that was an ideal worth fighting for and dying for. So thank you very much, Sagarika. It was fascinating. Your book really is a riveting read. It's a potboiler. And as I said, it's a distillate. No primary material, but it's the best compendium of material that you could want to come across. Do pick it up. She's there to sign it. The books are there. And look forward to seeing all of you in larger numbers in our next get-together. We'll be in touch. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.